WYFF News 4, live local breaking news at 6.
Good evening, I'm Michael Cogdill.
And I'm Gabrielle Komorowski, and tonight for Carol. So-called bath salts and synthetic marijuana are now banned in three upstate counties, Greenville, Anderson, and Greenwood.
Those county councils banned them last night with a real sense of emergency. News 4's Angela Rodriguez is live in our digital studio with what the stores and the deputies are having to do now. And Angela, still a lot of confusion out there about this.
Right. Most people have no idea what these so-called bath salts even look like, but basically it's street slang for chemical compounds that will get you high. And to ease some of that confusion, here are some of the brand names for you. Mad Hatter, Mr. Miyagi's War Paint. You certainly won't find these in grocery stores, but deputies know what to look for, and they're already going into stores.
Those looking for a legal high were met with empty shelves. The rules of the free market synthetic enterprise have changed overnight. Companies can no longer get around the law by adding the phrase, not for human consumption. Greenville County passed an emergency ordinance banning so-called bath salts and fake pot effective immediately. Rather than face a hefty fine, many store owners yanked their most popular.
This is more of like the herbal incenses.
And most profitable products.
And this is like the bath salts.
These synthetic substances sold by the gram are the new craze.
Both were illegal yesterday and I guess today. Oh well.
Can't sell it.
It is what it is.
Synthetic compound chemicals in all forms are forbidden for the next 60 days in three upstate counties. The catalyst behind the emergency ban is the death of 19-year-old Lamar Jack. A coroner ruled the Anderson University basketball player's organs failed after he tried synthetic marijuana earlier this month. The fake pot, as it's called, is not illegal. The potential danger isn't scaring customers away either. But the financial penalty is enough to force businesses into taking a legal product off of the shelves.
We're a legitimate business, so still got to abide by the law.
Businesses are already feeling the sting, stuck now with thousands of dollars worth of goods and no legal recourse.
We're going to enforce this ordinance in a number of different ways, including citizen complaint.
Within hours of the ban, Greenville County put more than 20 deputies on the streets, going store to store looking for violations.
Now, having or selling bath salts will not send you to jail. For now, it's just a fine, but state and federal lawmakers are certainly feeling the pressure thanks to these name brands, and there is movement to make these chemicals illegal. Angela Rodriguez, WYFF News 4, live tonight in our digital studio.
Angela, thank you. And many of you on Facebook have weighed in on the ban. And here's a look at some of the comments. Amy said, quote, they need to ban them permanently everywhere. And from Jen, quote, does no one realize that all these manufacturers have to do is change one ingredient, rename it, and bam, it's back on the market. Lenora said, quote, South Carolina is doing something right in a hurry for a change. And finally, Megan wrote, quote, this is what my family has been praying for. I've had people in my family that have done this, and it's been very terrifying to watch them on this. People do not understand what this drug really does. It causes them to see demonic and evil things, end quote. And we would like to hear what you have to say about the bath salts ban. We've set up a survey for you on our website. And here's the question. Three upstate counties passed emergency ordinances that banned the sale or possession of bath salts and other synthetic drugs. Do you agree with this decision? So far, 88% say yes, 7% say no, and 5% say I don't care. You will find that survey on the front page of WYFF4.com.
Okay, we've had some good and much needed rain. Now comes the dose of cold reality. Emphasis on the cold. Chief Meteorologist John Sesswich is here. John, big, big difference from Monday, brother.
Oh, I tell you, Michael. Yeah, yesterday we were in the 80s throughout the entire Western Carolinas and northeastern Georgia. And today we warmed up briefly as expected around midday into the mid-60s to upper 60s. And then the cold front passed by. And, yeah, reality sank in. Take a look. It is cold outside. Temperatures have dropped off into the 50s across the area. And temperatures will continue to slowly drop. But the wind chills, it already feels like the 40s out there with the strong west to southwesterly wind. So the cold air coming in, the general soaking rains that we had yesterday evening through most of the day today now is pushed off to the northeast. The colder, drier, somewhat drier air coming in now from the west and northwest. Rain showers, though, back into Kentucky and Tennessee. That'll arrive into the higher elevations of the mountains of North Carolina along the Tennessee border late tonight. And that could be in the form of snow showers. We'll talk more about that in detail a little bit later on. Now back to you, Gabrielle.
We will see you in a bit, John. Thank you very much. The South Carolina Supreme Court will hear a case that challenges the state's first in the South presidential primary. Greenville, Spartanburg, Chester, and Beaufort counties filed a lawsuit on Monday challenging the State Election Commission's authority to force the counties to pick up part of the tab for the primary. The state Supreme Court today said the four counties and the state must file papers by Tuesday.
A vigil is planned for tonight for the four family members who were killed in Pickens County last week. The crime happened Friday on Pinedale Road. Investigators say brothers Matthew and Marshall Hendricks, their father Mark, and their grandmother Linda Burns were all found dead in two separate homes. The vigil begins tonight at 7 o'clock. It's happening at the old high school stadium in Liberty. News 4's Mandy Gaither is there. She'll cover it for us. And you can see her story tonight right here on WYFF News 4 at 11.
Soon, just turning the lights on could cost you more. Duke Energy Carolinas is asking the Public Service Commission of South Carolina to raise electric rates by approximately 15%, but it wants to hear from you first. According to the company, if rates are adjusted, a typical residential customer whose normal bill is around $99 would see an increase of around $15 per month. We're told that 90% of that rate increase will allow Duke Energy to recover $6.5 billion that the company recently invested into the power grid.
You know, obviously, we recognize that with the challenges of this economy, that no one likes rate increases, but they are necessary to ensure the availability of affordable, reliable, and clean electricity, not just today, but for decades to come.
And if you would like to voice your feelings on the rate increase, Duke Energy's public hearing just got underway at Spartanburg Community College. It started at 6 o'clock.
We don't hear about this kind of thing every day. Thankfully, nearly 50 wild, even exotic animals were set loose overnight in Zanesville, Ohio. Investigators say the farm's owner committed suicide shortly after. The sheriff's office there says Terry Thompson released the animals and even disabled the cages to make sure they couldn't be used again. Those animals include Bengal tigers, leopards, lions, wolves, bears, and monkeys. Schools in the area, as you might imagine, had to close. Warning signs went up on the roads, and authorities got busy searching with orders to shoot to kill.
I know some animal rights folks are going to go nuts over this. That's fine. They can do all they want to, but the sheriff did the right thing.
Now, late word out of Ohio tonight, there are only two animals left out there, a wolf and a monkey. Thompson did not leave a suicide note, so investigators say they may never know if he released those animals as a final act of kindness or cruelty. Much more on this story coming next right here on the NBC Nightly News.
Despite the recent rain that we're experiencing, we unfortunately are still under a moderate drought, and some upstate cities are in protection mode when it comes to Lake Hartwell. The waterway is now 9 feet below where it should be. News 4's Keisha Foster is joining us live and local from the Anderson Newsroom. And Keisha, some communities are going on voluntary water restrictions now.
That's right, Gabrielle. This week, the Clemson City Council adopted a resolution for its residents and businesses to voluntarily cut back on water use.
Our drinking water does come from Hartwell, but it comes all the way up from Anderson.
The city of Clemson, as well as Clemson University, are doing their parts to protect the precious resource. Voluntary restrictions usually go into effect when Hartwell drops below 652 feet. It's now at 651. And during this time, watering should be done in the early morning or late evening. Water customers are also asked to cut back in other ways.
Now, when it comes to use of water that's beyond the normal daily use, like washing cars, watering your lawn, those kind of things.
During the last state drought response committee meeting in late September, the group raised the upstate's status to moderate. And according to state climatologists, this area is in for a drier fall and winter.
Also, the Powdersville Water District is also cutting back on water usage. Keisha Foster, WYFF News 4, live in the Anderson Newsroom.
From Studio One at Broadcast Place, live local breaking news continues.
Okay, this might have happened to you. You're trying to figure out what to do somewhere in Greenville County and you're at a loss, or the family can't agree. Well, one development group hopes to answer that big question, what do you want to do, with a big project aimed at showcasing all the upstate has to offer. Here now is News 4's Kim Quintero.
$23 million. That's how much money will be pumped into this plot of land on River Street in downtown Greenville, where an old abandoned warehouse sits, marks the future home of Reedy Square, a state-of-the-art tourist center.
we'll be able to showcase what all is going on in the upstate, so when people come here, they'll want to stay here, they'll want to spend more money here.
Chairman of the Economic Development Group overseeing the project, Paul Wickensheimer of Dream Big Greenville, says the facility will be more than a brochure stand.
They'll be able to, as I say, grab a sandwich. They'll be able to rent a bike and go down the Swamp Rabbit Trail. They'll be able to view art that's displayed here.
I'm told this land was bought for roughly about $3 million, but that warehouse isn't expected to come down for another year, and construction won't be complete for another 3 years.
But it'll be a mammoth structure that people will want to see and want to visit and climb all over and bring their friends to just to see what's going on.
The woman in charge of making it happen, Patty Maccabee. Wednesday morning, Dream Big Greenville announced they hired her as their president. Maccabee's first line of duty, find money to pay for the facility. So far, Greenville County promised to pay for $5 million of the project, while the city of Greenville pledged $3.5 million, which Wickensheimer says comes from taxes paid on accommodations and restaurants. The rest will be raised through a capital campaign, and once complete, Wickensheimer says it will run on self-generated revenue.
The Convention and Visitors Bureau is charged to have their offices located there. We'll have local artists that will pay a small fee to be able to display their art. We'll have a caterer that will operate a cafe there.
Big plans to highlight Greenville County as a world-class destination. Kim Quintero, WYFF News 4, Greenville.
Now, Kim also found that once Reedy Square is done, construction on its counterpart, the Blue Wall Center, is going to start. That facility is going to showcase what to do in the mountains of Greenville County.
What to do today, get your umbrella and a coat.
Stay
John.
Warm.
And a coat. Yeah, you probably don't need the umbrella now, because if you were holding the umbrella out there, you'd probably be like Mary Poppins.
That's true.
Because the winds are so strong out there. I'll show you the wind speed in just a second. First of all, the main good soaking rains that we had yesterday evening through the most of the day today has now shifted off to our northeast. And as you can see on live Super Doppler 4HD, no precipitation, cloud cover. Yeah, look at that little pocket of clearing skies. Downsloping winds kind of descends and heats and dries the atmosphere just briefly. And in eastern part of Oconee County, you folks in Clemson, Pickens, Easley, Liberty, all looking in central, all looking pretty clear in northern Anderson County, even you folks in Belton, Honeyapath, and into downtown Greenville. Little pocket of clear skies all around us. Clouds, strong winds outside the Greenville area right now with sunshine, currently 54 degrees. If you liked yesterday's warmth, well, it's going to be a while before you get back into the 80s again as far as temperatures go. Probably have to wait until maybe next spring. Southwest wind at 22, gusting to near 40 miles per hour, relative humidity at 64% and going down. Partly cloudy to mostly cloudy skies in Spartanburg right now, 55 degrees. Southwest wind, these are sustained winds at 25 miles per hour with gusts to 35 to 40 miles per hour, relative humidity at 64%. Mostly cloudy in Anderson right now, 52 degree temperature, very cool. And it feels like the low 40s with the wind chills. Westerly wind at 20 miles per hour, gusting over 30 miles per hour, relative humidity at 71%. Overcast skies in Asheville are already 46 degrees. Northerly wind at 20 miles per hour, gusting to around 32 miles per hour, and relative humidity high at 80%. So a little pocket of clearing skies right over Greenville. Everybody else is socked in with the clouds. Wraparound moisture out here in western Kentucky and Tennessee. That'll move into the mountains in North Carolina a little bit later on tonight. And along the higher elevations, and especially close to the Tennessee border, it could mix with wet snow and possibly even change to some snow showers late tonight, early tomorrow morning. Look how cold it is to our west. Here comes the cold air, 49 already in Chattanooga, 46 in Bristol. And notice how warm it is east of the front. It was 84 degrees right now in Myrtle Beach. So here comes the cold air, 45 in Franklin already, 53 degrees in Greenwood, 43 currently in Boone. High temperatures right around noontime today, mid to upper 60s. And then the temperatures continue to drop. Rainfall amounts, good soaking rains over the last 24 hours, 87 hundredths of an inch of rain in Greenwood and in Asheville, 3/4 of an inch of rain in Clemson, almost 3/4 of an inch of rain in Spartanburg and in Anderson, and almost 6/10 of an inch of rain in downtown Greenville. Nationally, look at all this rain, the wraparound moisture. It's raining up in Boston where it's currently 55 degrees. Here comes the cold air sinking into the south from the northwest. So with that strong wind tomorrow, we'll start off with maybe some snow showers, higher elevations along the Tennessee-North Carolina border. That'll start to lift off to the north. Plenty of sunshine outside of the mountains tomorrow, but with the strong winds, it's going to feel pretty chilly, to say the least. Here's our forecast in for tonight. Low 38 in the mountains, 42 in the upstate, breezy and colder. Windy and cold tomorrow in the mountains, high only in the upper 40s, maybe low 60s, could be only in the upper 50s, with mostly sunny to partly sunny skies tomorrow in the upstate. Diminishing winds tomorrow night and cold, low in the upper 30s to low 40s in the upstate, mid-30s probably in the mountains. And then cold at night, but pleasant during the day over the weekend with plenty of sunshine.
30 sightings. There they are.
Oh,
all
you hate
over.
It, don't you?
I don't like it.
Here we go.
I don't dig it. But we needed that rain.
Let's go to Florida. Yeah,
that's right.
True.
John, thanks.